So, very good morning to everyone present here. And I am Dr. Rajkumar Arya, Associate Professor in Department of Chemical Engineering, NIT Jalandhar, the coordinator of this this international short-term course on current and future scope of the surface coating. Today is day third of our short-term course and organized by our Department of Chemical Engineering. And convener of this course is Dr. Sangeeta Garg, the head of the department. And patron is Dr. Lalit Kumar Awasthi, sir, director, NIT Jalandhar. So the speaker of today's talk is first is Mr. Praveer Kumar Das, who will talk on UV curing growth driver for surface coating industries. So before we start the session, let me introduce Mr. Praveer Kumar Das to everyone present here. We have amidst us Mr. Praveer Kumar Das, who is a surface coating specialist. Mr. Das is enriched with 29 years of professional experience, having been associated with Berger Paints Overseas Limited as factory head, where he looked after projects, production planning, control, and executions. Prior to that, he was associated with Shalimar Paints at DGM Manufacturing and Berger Jensen and Nicholson Nepal Private Limited in various capacities. He also worked as R&D chemist with AkzoNobel, formerly ICI Paints and Asian Paints. Mr. Das was also a visiting guest lecturer to the several government institutions under the Department of Industries. On the educational front, Mr. Das pursued BSc Honors Chemistry from Vidyasagar College under Kolkata University. He also pursued PG Diploma in Paint and Varnish Technology from Industrial Research Laboratory and a PG Diploma in Operation Management. Mr. Das is the recipient of several certificates and cash awards at the professional level for the best suggestions and implementations of suggestions on factory safety, health, and environment while working at ICI Paint Limited, currently known as AkzoNobel. So with this short introduction, now I would like Mr. Das to conduct the session. Over to you, sir.
Okay, thank you and good morning to all the participants. I may take the opportunity to convey my gratitude to Dr. Raj, Madam Dr. Garg, and the director of NITJ and all faculty members. Today, my presentation will be a techno-commercial presentations where the technology meets the current demand of the industries. I will discuss on strength, weakness, opportunities and threats. My discussions will be in two parts. The first part is about the global scenario of the paint businesses, where it stands, the economic conditions, and where the opportunities to grow. What type of coating is to grow? And the second part, I will discuss especially on powder coatings, low temperature curing powder coatings, which is assumed to be the growth driver or one of the fastest growth drivers in the near decades. So let me start. The global position as of now, the current global population is about 7.8 billion, of which middle class consumer is estimated to be 5.3 billion. That is almost 68% of the total population is the middle class. This middle class consumer actually controls the market dynamics. At the same time, the global leaders have taken oath to reduce carbon emission of 42% within the next 10 years. That is by 2030, the global carbon reduction must be reduced to 42% level. And this is achievable. This is achievable through convergence of sources and diversifying the energy mix. We have been using fossil fuels. Now our attention is shifting to the biofuels, from biofuels to renewables and renewables to nuclear energy. So whole motto of the global leaders and the global population, I would say, to reduce the emissions and make this world a beautiful place to live in. In the next slide, I am talking about the global scenario of the paint business, as we are now interested to be the expert in our surface coating industries. The surface coating industries plays an important role in the paints, in the business, in the global business. Global coating market 2020 is 107 billion gallons with a business value of US$147 billion. It is not a worst figure. Because of this present COVID pandemic situation, the paint business is in the healthy level. By 2025, the business is expected to grow up to $180 billion with a compounded annual growth rate of 4% between 2020 and 2025. So within 5 years, there will be a quantum jump in the growth. The first top 11 global paint manufacturers, however, have registered combined sales revenue loss of 17% in 2020 because of the situations we are everybody aware of it. But till there will be an expected CAGR growth of 4% within the next 5 years. The waterborne technology segment is expected to hold the largest share of the overall paints and coatings market during the forecast period. Because at present, the scientists, the technocrats, and the experts have only tipped liquids, that is water, which is the most eco-friendly component of our life. So all focus is there to develop waterborne technology to those areas, convert those areas which are solvent borne and pollute the environment. The paints and coatings market in the architectural end use industry is expected to witness the highest CAGR during the forecast period. Architectural end use industries are those industries which produce to the architectural finishes. So these are the industries like the, you can see a simple example I want to give you, the window frames. Initially, we used to put wooden window frames. And for that, we had to cut the forest, deforest, and which pollutes the environment of our deforestation attitudes. So it is being now replaced with aluminum sheets, plastic sheets, where we can use this technology to give a waterborne technology finishes to these items so that by the way we can save our forest, we can save our greeneries, and we can reduce the pollution of our environment. APS paints and coatings market, this is APS paints and coatings market, is estimated to register the highest CAGR during the forecast period. Owing to the increasing demand from industrial applications and improving economic conditions, the countries like China, Japan, India, Indonesia, Taiwan, and Thailand will see the major boom in paints and coating business. Now let us come to our country's paint business scenario. The size of the Indian paint industry is around 1,000 million liters. Last 10 years, the Indian paint industry has grown at a compounded annual growth rate of more than 12% and is expected to maintain the same percentage in the next 5 years. Here I want to highlight the Asian Pacific region countries have a 12% of CAGR growth, whereas the Europeans and the Western world, they are scrubbing around 5 to 6% CAGR growth. In India, 70% of our market is controlled by the organized sector. By organized sectors, I mean the branded companies which we are accustomed with. And the remaining 30% is with the small scale units or the medium scale units. Of the 1,000 million liters, the 50% of the total volume and 60% of the total revenue is controlled by these organized sectors. And the rest is occupied by the medium scale sectors. The Indian paint market is expected to reach business value around 71,000 crore with 43% growth by 2022 years, the next 2 years, if everything goes well and provided we get COVID-19 vaccine as fast as possible. The future of consumption in India in 2030 is anchored in rising middle class incomes and a broad-based pattern of growth and benefit sharing. That's why I mentioned in my beginning of the slide that about 68% approximately of the world population is the middle class consumer. And it is the middle class consumer who plays a pivotal role in the paints business or any type of business. It is estimated that the growth rate of the middle class will lift nearly 25 million households out of poverty. The good sign of the middle class people is that they actually vie for education, better standards of living, and care for their families rather than frittering away their wealth. Here, India plays a very important role because Indian middle class families concentrate on these three parameters, better living and high thinking. Whereas in the Western, I've seen in the Western society, people what they earn, they spend the money. They think of the present, not for the future, because the social responsibilities are being taken care of the government of their respective countries. By 2030, 40% of Indians will be urban residents. There will, however, be more than 5,000 small urban towns and more than 50,000 developed rural towns with similar income profiles, where aspirations are fast converging with those of the urban India. The pattern of life and the demand for the life is converging to a middle-class urban society. Physical connectivity, digital connectivity, and income are constraining the spending and well-being of rural dwellers. And these access barriers, these are the barriers for social upliftment, which I say need to be addressed to ensure social and economic inclusion in India over the next decade. And I think you will agree the present government is vying for that. The above mentioned factors are open up opportunities for the entire industry in both domestic and industrial areas, and will continue to attract competition from domestic entrepreneurs and international paint majors. Many international paint majors have already set their footprints in our country, and many are yet to come. And they come not through the channel of surface coatings. It may be beverages, it may be fragrances, it may be flavors, many aspects of the business. The West is now looking towards the East. Efficient raw materials procurement, new products and technologies are the futuristic solutions to focus on reducing costs and increasing shareholders' wealth. Because you know, there is the shareholders who are also the owners of the industries for the public limited holding companies. They invest money for the growth of the industries. So the consumers or the producers have to look after the shareholders' interests also. So if the company grows, the business grows, revenue earning increases, and the society gets benefited. Nearly 10 to 12 million working age people will emerge in India over the next decade, and the country faces a huge challenge in providing the workforce with the right skills and gainful employment to enable their income growth. It is estimated that more than half of the Indian workers will require reskilling by 2022. To meet the talent demands of the future. So naturally, if the technology develops, the manpower who runs the technology, who operates the technology, who develops the technology has to be developed. So this is going to be a challenge in the future, and the company is trying to make its own contribution in this space through setting up several mobile demo training centers as a part of the computer, the society involvement, society responsibility, as companies, society responsibilities. Companies are coming forward to develop the society in terms of giving knowledge to the people, which may, I can say a few examples. Companies like Asian Paints and Berger, they are already working on it. Companies like ITC, if you see, go through the internet and search, they are playing a havoc role in this social responsibility areas. Similarly, demand for paints will increase and will solely not depend on good monsoon. Earlier, like Indian economies, the growth of paint industry is to depend on the season of monsoon. Better monsoon means better opportunity of the paint growth. But this has now been shifted. If the technology develops, if the process develops and becomes eco-friendly and consumer-friendly, the business will develop automatically. So this is the commercial and economic aspects of the paint business, which play an important role in the growth driver for the future surface coating industries and all others likewise. Gentlemen, if you have any questions, you can ask me.
Yes, sir. From here, we want to learn the things.
Okay. So, let's...
So, we are getting the idea how the things work worldwide, actually. So, we are getting the things, and let's see.
And the product-wise paints market share. Now I'm coming to our main topics of surface coating, the paints or the print coatings. Anything that coats the surface comes under surface coating. Here we see the solvent coatings occupy 65% of the volume. Waterproof coatings 25% and powder coatings is 10%. This is their share in terms of the volume. Now I have given you a map, is mainly for the UV coat coatings market mapping. This is the map. You see there are three colors: green, yellow, and pink. Green constitutes Asia Oceania regions, where I have mentioned already. APEC countries will have a tremendous future growth in this area. This is the higher growth, followed by the European continent and the North American continent. It have a medium growth. And low growth is observed in the Latin America, in Africa, and some parts of the Middle East countries. This is mainly for the UV coating markets. In the UV coating business in the Asia-Pacific regions, as I mentioned earlier, increased at a CAGR of more than 7%. China and Japan are the primary consumers of UV coatings in this region. At present, the demand of UV coatings at Indian subcontinent is low, but it is expected to increase significantly in the near future. South Korea and Taiwan will also observe the growth in these coating markets because of stringent regulations formulated by their authorities and to promote eco-friendly products and processes. So also is in our country, India is also. China and India once emerged as the largest producer of automotive. In 2018 till 2020, the country witnessed about 8.2% decline in these vehicles. We know, we are aware of it. However, this can be compensated by the growth of demand in furniture industries and protective coatings, where UV coating system will be appreciated. Till now, the protective coatings, which are used mainly in the turnkey projects, like tank painting, oil tanks painting, bridge painting, offshore petroleum rigs, the structural coatings, these are all protective coatings, which is totally relying on solvent-based systems. So effort from the scientist level or the researchers level is to convert it to a water thinnable, or if we at least reduce solvents to a certain extent by water and reduce VOC of the society. Like China, India government is also planning to construct about 100 airports in the country by 2032. It's a really massive and optimistic project by the government of India. This is further likely to drive the demand for commercial jets, and in turn is expected to drive the demand of UV coatings in the next 12 years. Similar is the case with Japan, which is manufacturing F-35, a next generation fighter jets and other military and cargo aircrafts. So if the aircraft industry booms, automatically they are using many accessories and components where the coatings are being cured by the ultraviolet curing or electron beam system. So the aforementioned factors are expected to drive the demand for the UV cure coatings in the region during this forecast period. To have a prosperous business for the future period, manufacturers are revisiting the market dynamics and coming up with innovative products and business strategies to sustain and maintain the growth of revenues. After all our research and development works, which we have carried out by different institutes, the ultimate goal is to practicalize it, to commercialize it, so that the society is benefited by the industries. So we have to understand little bits of the market dynamics and how, by implement, studying and revisiting market dynamics, the end of the day, the revenue can be increased. Market dynamics are the forces which impact prices and the behaviors of producers as well as the consumers. Other than price, demand and supply, human emotions also drive decisions, influence the market and create price signals. Here I want to mention the how human emotions play an important role. For example, when you paint your house, you just not paint it for protection of your surface. You paint it to give an aesthetic value or a decorative value. Where your human emotions of your family members play an important role. You go to the retailers or the dealers, they see the color palettes or the shade curves. You choose the shades. Here also your human psychology plays an important role. Then you select the shades, you purchase the shades, and you apply the shades. And here and there you satisfy your human emotions. So human emotions, rather I will point it as a most important market dynamics. In a market forces, which result from the fluctuations of supply and demand for a given product or services under a given situation, to control industrial policy as well as government policy. And you should remember that market dynamics are not constant. It's always very fluctuating. So it is necessary to constantly reevaluate them before making investment or business decisions. So whenever you get a developed or research product, which in the laboratory scale is successful, and when you plan to implement and commercialize that development, so you have to look at of the commercial aspects of the formulations of the products or the services. Then and then only you can succeed. Potential market drivers for surface coating industries. As my earlier predecessor has already told, that development of low VOC products, water thinnable emulsion products, that is in case of decorative paints, both for interior and exterior surfaces, is one of the market driving dynamics or the market drivers. Development of antibacterial antivirus paints. It is the most demanding and cry of the present situations. All the paints industries who are looking at the decorative as well as industrial industries, they are developing products and paints which can give a good antibacterial antivirus paints and which can claim that 99.99% germ killing will be possible if the surface is coated or if that surface coats are utilized. Introduction of new technology to improve environment friendly and user friendly protective coatings which guarantee multi-year long life. As I have mentioned earlier, that protective coatings are now switching over to waterborne coatings. But protective coatings of solvent boosts guarantee 10 to 12 years, even 15 years service life. So the waterborne coating technology should also aim at multi-year long life guarantee. In that case, and that case only, that product will be acceptable by the end users. Switch over from solvent-borne coatings to water-borne coatings with special anti-fridge properties, faster curing time with excellent flow and leveling need to be addressed, as it is one of the market drivers of the surface coating industries. Popularizing the usage of environment-friendly and commercially viable powder coatings for pipeline manufacturing industries to shipbuilding industries. So powder coating industries now shifting from small articles or in a narrow dimension articles to a huge dimension articles. So for pipeline coatings, you can understand the meters of pipe will be coated to the powder coatings. So the setup is required for proper baking and curing systems. To the shipbuilding industries, where the accessories and equipments of the shipbuilding engineering items can be coated with UVPO powder coatings, which can via economic environment friendly products. These efforts can only minimize the greenhouse effect and save your powder coatings, which can be via economic environment friendly products. These efforts can only minimize the greenhouse effect and save energy and money in curing paint film through UV and electron beam system with no emissions of volatile organic compounds. Development of acrylics and silicone-based binders for waterproof and fireproof surface coatings, both for the decorative and industrial segments. Surface coats are, now I'm coming to the definition of surface coats. You are all aware of it. Surface coats is what? The most simplest way to understand for the layman, I will say surface coats are nothing but a mechanical mixtures in liquid, paste, or dry powder form. This is surface coating. Surface coatings can also be defined as polymeric compounds composed of pigments, binders, solvents, and different functional additives, which when applied on surface forms a protective layer with aesthetic value after being cured. Each component, what I am mentioning here, has a definite role in the performance of the coatings. Pigments gives opacity, pigments gives colors, pigments contribute to gloss. Binders, this is the vehicle or which binds the different components and which forms the film after curing, is the mainly the polymers that play an important role in the success of the surface coatings. And the solvents. Solvents are cutting as a transporter or the vehicles from one area to the other area of applications, establish pigments, binders, and additives, and give a proper pure film with proper leveling. There are several functional additives, volatile and volatile additives up there, which contribute to specialized properties of the paint film. Anything that coats the surface that comes under surface coating technology, it may be paints, may be printing ink, may be laminations, may be glazing of tiles, or ceramic coatings for automobile. What is curing? Curing is the process which results to the formation of continuous films either through physical curing or through chemical curing or by both physical and chemical curing. I'm giving a little bit examples for the understandings. Physical curing is the air drying decorative emulsion paints, for an example, where when you apply the paint, water is the solvent that plays an important role here. After application of the paint, water evaporates and the emulsion particles with other components of the paints, they coalesce, come together, fuse together and form a continuous film. This is a physical curing. Chemical curing. This is applicable for stopping enamel paints in OEM finish. OEM is original equipment manufacture finish. Where they use baking paints. It may be acrylic amino system, alkyd amino systems, where the polymers cross-link to chemical reactions with the cross-linker and paints forms a tough film after baking. The chemical curing takes place. There is physicochemical curing. This is applicable for thermosetting powder coatings, where at higher temperature, physical sintering of the particles takes place, followed by chemical reaction. What happens? That is a process. Suppose you imagine a fluid bed tanks consisting of powders. There is a sintered plate at the bottom with a specific particle, specific distributions and the dimensions of the holes. Through these holes, high air pressure is pumped in. The powders, they form aerosol types, like a boiling liquids. You dip the surface with the powder coatings into the bed. Of course, the temperature of the surface should be higher than the melting point of the powder coatings. The powders that is coated on the surface come together, sinter and fuse together, and then the chemical reaction takes place, and ultimately, a curing process is achieved. This is called physicochemical curing. Just a minute. This is the process of schematic presentations of UV curing. The diagram is just to understand easily the how the sintering process takes place. And after the curing, the crosslink density is formed, it retains shapes. As soon as the fluid layer is subjected to UV irradiation, the coatings form an inert film without emitting VOC and without loss of the film thickness. Here, 100% conversion of the wet film to dry film takes place without compromising film thickness. And this is the unique features of the UV curing system. And this is one of the important features why UV curing system is gaining popularity. Under this curing system, liquid or powder paint film or the ink layer dries and matures, but in different manner as opposed to existing thermal or baking system. As I have mentioned, in case of auto-air coatings, evaporation system, in case of architectural finishes, or air drying oxidative polymerization system, in the decorative enamel finishes or the refinish areas or the garage areas where your automobiles or furnitures are refinished with enamel paints and is dried naturally. The solvents evaporate. The dryer plays an important role in curing the paint film. Now I am coming, since I am talking about ultraviolet radiation system, so you are, everybody, you are aware of it. It is the spectra of the ultraviolet. Why you see 100 nanometer to 400 nanometers is the main span of all the ultraviolets, of which I have split it into four categories. That is black light zone between 300 to 400 nanometers, erythema, germicidal, and industrial curing that covers a zone of 200 to about 460 nanometers. Our topics of interest is this region where the UV curing effectively occurs. As per the spectrum, as shown in the figure 2, it is UVA, which is termed as black light, that lies between 320 nanometer to 400 nanometer, and it is the medium wavelength range. UVB, or the erythema, that is lies between 280 nanometer to 320 nanometer, and is termed as short medium wavelength range. UVC, or the germicidal, that is between 200 nanometer and 300 nanometer, that is the short wavelength range. We have also UVV. This is a long wavelength between 300 nanometer to 460 nanometer. Depending on thickness of the coating materials, effective UV deep curing takes place in between 315 nanometer to 380 nanometer, and which suits to all industrial finishes, both for the printing ink and the paints. That is, the curing, after curing, the paint film attains hardness and attains other properties which can match with the requirements of the industries. These industries include surface coating industries, printing ink industries. The photons of the electromagnetic spectra that have energies ranging from 300 to 760 kilojoule per mole matches with the bond energy of the unsaturated binders, having sufficient double bonds to split and initiate the chain propagation reactions. So from 300 to 760 range, depending upon your selection of the paints and the nature of coatings and the nature of surface, the coat provides the bond energy that can initiate the photopolymerization reaction. This curing process generally takes place under the blanket of inert gases. During inertization, the oxygen is irradiated area is replaced with the inert gas, mainly nitrogen, and sometimes also with carbon dioxide. Depending on types of surface and coats, the formulator designs a recipe containing photoinitiator only, or sometimes with photosensitizers. So gentlemen, what I want to say, the UV coatings is little bit different from the coatings what are generally used in the industries. The formulations will be different, preparations will be different, applications will be different. free radicals generated from the photoinitiator or from photosensitizer, photosensitizer can term it as a photoinitiator A, that reacts with oxygen molecules, and in fact, the surface cross-linking is hampered because oxygen attracts the molecules, free radicals, and converts to ozone, which is also a concerning factor during this process. So the inertization is most important with the nitrogen, which replaces oxygen, minimizes the scope of ozone formations, and give a proper curing with sufficient availability of the free radicals. Free radicals actually trigger free radical polymerization of the double bonds of the polymeric binders like acrylates or unsaturated polyesterases. Once the UV radiation starts, we know that initiation, propagations, followed by polymerization reactions with chain terminations takes place. And it takes place very fast with a few fraction of seconds. The chain termination takes place by the recombinations of the coupling free radical transfer or the disproportionation, that is hydrogen atom transfer with simultaneous formation of double bonds. This is the basic technology of the photopolymerization reactions, which you everybody knows. This is the schematic arrow diagram to visualize how it reacts. See, the free radicals in presence of air atmosphere reacts with oxygen and interrupts the polymerization reaction of the surface pores. Whereas in the inert atmosphere, there are sufficient free radicals are available to split the double bond of the unsaturated binders like acrylates and polyesters, propagates and polymerizes. In the next below, I am showing the comparative pictures of thermal curing and UV curing. Thermal curing, what I was talking about, auto OEM curing system. In this system, what happens? The paint contents, binders, pigments, solvents, additives, etc. And when it is subject to thermal curing, that is by normal baking system, oven curing, or infrared curing, or in near infrared curing, what happens? The solvent substrates that go away come to the environment, and the non-volatile parts of the paint materials form a cured film over the substrate. Here you see the length of the film. The wet film thickness is much higher than the dry film thickness. Depending upon the volume solids, the dry film thickness depends. If your volume solid, say, is about 80%, volume solid here, I am talking about the volume of the non-volatile part of the paint materials, and your wet film thickness is 200 micron, then after thermal curing, you will achieve 200 multiplied by 80%. That will be 160 micron. So you are losing about 40 microns of materials, which is merely a wastage. Wastage of materials is wastage of money, and it pollutes the environment. But in the UV curing part, you see, the UV paints composed of oligomers, polymers, I will say, monomers, photoinitiators, and several functional additives. When it is subjected to UV radiations, the cross-link takes place in the substrate, and it forms a solid layer on the substrate. If you see, the thickness is not changed at all, because there is no loss in the of the paint materials. The 100% conversion, what I told you earlier, the 100% conversion of wet film thickness to the dry film thickness is achievable by UV curing system. So gentlemen, you can understand the importance of the UV curing system, which is the most lucrative curing system where both consumer and the producer can have financial gains. The reactions for the chain termination to show you.
Excuse me, sir.
Hello.
Does it happen automatically also in case of, let's say we are quoting in outside of our building somewhere, so UV radiations, some percentages are there on Earth also. Would it happen that way also?
No, it will. It is, doctor. It is way that we are developing the products for the architectural finishes. But you know, this is all the prefabricated items of the architectures that is coated by UV cure. So, in the you want to utilize the ultraviolet from the light sources available naturally. This is not possible in the architectural finishes, outside architectural finishes. It is for the industrial
Okay.
finishes.
Okay,
So
okay,
there's a
okay.
work is going on, but long way to go because you know that is that minimum in the UV coating, which I will come later on, the temperature requirement is low, though in the range of 90 degrees centigrade. But in the outside architecture finishes, we can achieve that temperature. At best, it will be 40 degrees centigrade, 50 degrees centigrade. So little bit of
Right,
thermal
right.
energy is required to initiate these reactions. This has not yet been possible in the normal decorative segments. Am I
Okay,
clear,
okay, okay.
doctor?
Yeah, sure. Okay, sir, go
So,
ahead.
the chain terminations, it is how the chain termination takes place, the recombinations, and how the disproportionation reaction takes place. After all, the main success of the UV curing system is that we have to terminate the reactions. There should not be any residual free radicals in the curing system. It will pose some problems, which I will discuss in my later course of my presentations. So, paint formulator needs tremendous expertise in designing the formulations of the products, right doses of initiators, right doses of sensitizers if required. That must match with what type of polymers or the binders you are selecting. So, it is a trial and error method to optimize the paint formulation. Care must be taken that there should not be any free radicals, mainly with respect to printing ink industries. Because what happens in the packaging materials where UV curing takes place, you store food materials for a long time. So there may be possibilities of transfer of free radicals to the food items, and which may degrade the quality of the food products, and it may be detrimental to the end consumer. So it has to be scientists or the research fellows has to be very cautious about the selections of the initiators so that proper termination takes place. Because the reaction, you know, is very fast, it's a very dynamic reactions. In that case, there may be possibilities, there may be excess free radicals may roam even in the cured film, which can migrate and deteriorate the whole part. Basic fundamental criteria of UV curing. This is the shortwave high energy UV radiation in the spectrum between 320 nanometer and 400 nanometer can convert liquid UV reactive substances into a solid film. Shorter wavelength UV radiations, you know, is less able to penetrate the surface and hence it can only influence the surface coatings, while the longer wavelength penetrates into the object. And it can influence the thorough curing of the film. So, while selecting UV lamps, we have to be very cautious. To what extent you need shorter wavelength UV and what extent you need longer wavelength UV. The main parameters depends upon the intensity, exposure, and the UV spectra. Intensity by means we mean power or density of the ultraviolet energy. Generally, we have seen that three or thousands to 3,000 milliwatts per square centimeter under UVV is a good intensity to give ideal conditions for proper curing because this high intensity can cure the paint film over a very short period of time. Next comes the exposure. The surface, how long it needs to be exposed under UV. It is similarly thousands to 3,000 millijoule per square centimeter under UVV. But the exposure is measured as a product of intensity, milliwatt per centimeter square into time. And what type of spectrums we need for clear coatings or tintable coatings, generally, mercury lamps, that is mercury vapor lamps are used. But for opaque paints, but there are pigments and fillers, we need a doping marker system, that is iron additive marker or gallium doped marker. And this is a picture where you can show the longer wave, that is a longer wave which influences the in-depth curing, or rather say thorough curing of the UV coats. A shorter wavelength merely influences the surface of the coating, that is the surface curing. This is a pictorial representation of the mercury lamps, which you are all accustomed with. It is a medium pressure mercury vapor lamps, which is commercially known as H or H plus bulbs, which emits a high intensity broadband mercury spectrum as standard, and is often labeled as 360 meter nanometer lamps or high pressure lamps. Depending upon their emission peak, these mercury lamps are labeled. It is called high pressure mercury lamps because mercury vapor under electric sparks get ionized and emit UV rays. By adding different dopings to the mercury, as I have mentioned earlier, is iron or gallium, the curing parameters can be optimized by the using of doped spectrum, which is dependent on end use of the formulations and its compositions. That is, what type of curing lamp you should require, that depends upon the paint compositions. Here, the suppliers of these UV coats will guide the user which type of options they will take. Because after all, the composition must suit and must have sufficient intensity energies of UV to have a proper curing at a shortest period of time. So paint compositions and the formulation plays an important role. So when the lamp ignites, the high voltage arc generates a plasma between the two electrodes, and this plasma emits the typical UV spectrum of the medium pressure lamps. Iron doped medium pressure mercury lamps, it is on UVA spectrum lamps, the UVA zones, it is also called metal halide lamps or D bulbs. This is used for deeper curing, for clear varnishes, coatings, adhesives or lacquers. Because here in these varnishes, the major part is the binders or the liquid materials, which have a very low tendency to cure. Where it is being curing is being induced by the ultraviolet lamps, where the metal mercury lamps, that is mercury vapor lamp, doped mercury vapor lamps, in the iron salts of halides, play an important role for the clear varnishes. Where for the pigmented paints, like normal paints, normal printing inks, normal furniture coating enamels, gallium doping proves to be very effective. And that is, since it cures the pigmented or the whites, it is referred to as the white cure bulbs, or sometimes it is referred to as V bulbs. Alternative options of source of UV energy is LED. This UV LEDs, they do not produce a broad UV spectrum, but it produces a very narrow band with high emission peak. And the other unique feature it is, it does not emit infrared irradiations, while there is possibility of IR irradiations in case of mercury lamps. For temperature sensitive materials, UV LED proves to be very effective, as it only produces marginal heat during curing process. The different spectra ensure safe and fast curing. It is also characterized by a very long life cycle. The operating cycle of mercury vapor lamp is found to be 1,000 to 4,000 hours. At best, UV-based microovens generating UV, they have an operating life cycle of about 6,000 hours. Whereas it's UV LED, you will find that operating life cycle is about 40,000 hours. So it is commercially really profitable to incorporate UV LED system in the curing process. And this UV LED curing system effectively cures the printing ink processing system, the flexo printing, lithographic printing, and for several wood coating lines in the curing stations. So UV LED must be preferred over Macquarie Drupal Labs. Nowadays, the curing systems are being designed keeping in mind the curing temperature, energy consumption, safety, and environment conditions. That is also the curing systems depends upon the curing temperature will depend upon the compositions of the paints, the nature of substrates, and what end user demands. Newer curing systems deliver less energy and eliminate shorter wavelength UV system. That means the developed systems of UV curing generates a high emission peak, narrow spectrum of UV with lower release of energy. Replacement of oxygen with inert media to decrease the impact of oxygen inhibition on UV curing system. As I have told you, that oxygen is the detrimental agent in this curing system. So we have to be very cautious in selecting the system where oxygen contamination can be avoided. Increasing the irradiation increases the concentration of free radicals, and higher concentration of free radicals lead to higher crosslink density. Whereas low energy cure systems with lower irradiance result in lower concentration of free radicals and less cross-linking density at the surface layer of the coating films. That means the lower energy curing systems is also required for certain products where surface can impact or can influence the surface curing system. This means the longer wavelength is required to give a thorough curing system. We have to give special attentions to the UV curing materials.
Hello, can I ask one question? Let's say we want to quantify the cross-linking density. So means generally what we do in practical, sometimes we put a cross-linker, or sometimes let's say we buy a polymer and we want to use our means it's study purpose. So we get average molecular weight and the number average molecular weight and mass average molecular weight. So we have some diffusion models where we need also a cross-link density value just to substitute also there. So what characterization techniques need to be used, or where are they available just to means find cross-link density?
That is a better way. The polymers what you are using, the supplier of the polymers will better guide you to what equipments or what instrument is required and what will be the reading parameters to determine the cross-link density. Here you don't in this system, we do not use any cross-linker here. I will come to the formulations where you will see the monomers that itself will act as a cross-link density, and it will be the purpose of 100% conversions of cross-link density of the chains, polymer chains will be possible, where you will not concentrate on the cross-linking centers, you can concentrate on the spread of the cross-link polymers, the cross-linking density. Am I clear to you, or am I?
Yeah, I am fine. But my question is that I would show you that we have some diffusion models developed a long time back by the renowned scientist actually, and we did some work or drying of cross-linking cross-link polymeric coatings. So, but we because we bought the polymer from the Sigma Aldrich. And nothing was given on the detail for cross-link density. They gave the average molecular weight and the number average molecular weight and its density only. Cross-link density was not available. So we were looking for how to find the cross-link density one. So unfortunately,
we didn't get. I will convey to you.
Sure.
You know, because okay. You know, this is some type of technical secrecy. They don't want to divulge the 100% truth to you.
Yeah, that is also mighty possible.
They will not give you. the system. After all, I will be in touch with you. I can give you the agencies or the instruments or the parameters. I can share with you that
information. Yeah, sure. Okay, sir.
That was
Thank
very
you
good
very much.
question, because after all, the cross-link density is the most important technical parameters for the success
Yeah,
of.
because once we are formulating a paint, or let's say we are doing the UV curing, or let's say in the curing in microwave something, so microwave assisted curing actually. So if we don't know density, so this model calculation part we cannot do theoretical calculation. Experimentally, we have okay. We did cross linking. We made test. Maybe it's hardness, it's crash test, something. But if we want to predict its drying behavior with some mathematical model, so it needs some parameters which are missing actually.
Okay, I can guide you in this way. I don't know how much it will help you. After curing the paint film, suppose in case
okay.
of UV curing, I will come also. I have an answer, not 100%, but 50% of the answer you will get it. What you can do, the film, what has been cured, you keep it in a, there's a test methods. That is methyl ethyl ketone rub test or acetone rub test.
Okay.
You select an area, specific areas. You give rub with a cotton cloth, soak it with acetone or methyl ethyl ketone, and you rub 5 times, 10 times, 7 times. One rub is come from one point to the other end, and you come back to the your initial point, it will be considered as one rub. So you give a rub test and you see the film, or the film deteriorates. First of all, what your visual observation will be matte. You will attain certain gloss or sheen level, but it will deteriorate, number one. So by glossometer, you test it. Then you get a simple, it is a very, since we are not a research guy, we are a Jogaru people, what we do, we scratch with the nail.
All the research is being done with based on Jugaad. First you do the experiment, then people come up with the model, right? Somehow to predict that.
Exactly, from end to
so,
start.
So the models has not come in the beginning. First this experiment people did, only then all these theories are developed.
Yes. Backward integrations. So
yes.
You can do the nail, the two-way test that we generally follow in the industries. Do it, scratch with your nail. You see the paint film becomes soft or not. You see the surface is visible. Paint is rolled up and visible. There you can understand that your model is successful or not. But you have to standardize to what rub test you will standardize. And then you can modulate your average molecular weight of the polymers. There is also coin test. After this rub test, the normal paint after curing, you scratch with a coin. One rupee coin, metal coin. So these are the basic, very thumb rule principle where you can assess the cross-link density of your polymer film. Am I right?
Yes. Thank you very much, sir. So I will take your further help actually the later in that.
Later,
so
you just keep it. Of course, I'll be in touch with you and later. So as per continuations, the UVA lamps primarily emit wavelength in the UVA range, that the black light regions, and most LED lamps also emit at 395 nanometer, which also lies in the UVA range. So our main motto of the curing system is to generate UVA in the black light regions. So that will give you successful curing of the UV coats. LED lamps with 385 nanometer and 405 nanometer emissions are also used. Lamps with 365 nanometers generally emit emissions at lower energy intensity. LED lamps have seen a steady increase in peak irradiance from 1.1 watts per square centimeter to 16 watts per square centimeter to the substrate, which is possible due to improvements in the optics of the UV LED. So you can play with the LED lamps. You can vary your intensity, energy intensity, through your optics of the UV LEDs as per your requirement of the curing system. This is the just pictorial representations, what I have said. You see the blue band is the mercury lamp band, and the dotted is the LED 365. the other curve is the LED 385, 395, and 400. You see the wavelengths, and you see the band. It's a very narrow band, but it's a very high peak. And that is more commercially suitable. In case of mercury lamp, you see the broad ranges of the band, range of the bands, but the effective is in the peak, in this peak, 365, around 365 is the region, is the effective peak area for the QoS. And the other bands' energies are the extraneous regions, are merely the wastage of energy, wastage of electrical consumptions. After all, electrical energy is converted to this light energy, and you can see the wastage of mercury lamp. So nowadays, UV LEDs are more preferred over mercury lamps. Now I'm come to the inertization of the system. Why inertization of the environment is important? Because it fastens the production speed with less doses of UV irradiations. Since there is no interfering of oxygen radicals or the free radicals, so UV irradiations with lesser doses of UV initiators is possible, and the reaction is speeded up. High crosslinks levels are achieved at the post-curing stages. It gives an excellent surface curing. Lower level of protein initiators is required, and hence very cost effective in terms of paint formulations, and less migrations. As I am saying, because of the optimized uses of photo initiators, there is less chance of the free radical residues, and hence less migrations. And less the migrations, there is no smell or reductions of smell, no yodeling tendency afterwards, and there is no chance of ozone productions. However, if the ozone production happens at any system, it can be sucked out by the present ventilation systems and converted to oxygen and released to the environment. There is also a system, precautionary measures to protect ozone. UV curing system coating compositions. Now I am coming to the coating compositions. These compositions will be different from our normal paint compositions. Here, formulator just incorporates photo initiators as one of the raw materials. And for better understanding, I will give you a formulations. This is a tentative research-based formulations. So don't think that it is a divergence of technical secrecy, no. This is to share with you the people so that you can be interested. Some of the future technocrats may be interested to go in the development of UV coating compositions. So for them, it is our guiding formulation. Some may go in the application science, the engineering science, where chemical engineering converges with the electrical and mechanical engineering, and they can design a most effective, more improved upper versions of the curing system with respect to the curing systems available in the present market. So I am now coming into the paint parts, a little bit to the technological part of the paints. So gentlemen, if you have any questions, please come forward.
Hello, good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon. This is Manju Rawal from Thapa University. I'm a student of Rajkumar Arya, sir.
Glad to be here.
Yes, sir. Sir, I have a question that I have prepared some like polymer solutions for coatings. If we increase the percentage of any ingredients like additives or any fillers, and we prepared the whole of the solution, the solution looked like homogeneous and already all dissolved solution is there. But when we prepared the coating, the coating is not there after the end of the drying. Like polymer is not there, it is only the filler, these additives, those appeared. So I want to know what is happening, like why it is like this. Because of 5% of these additives, fillers, or there is something else is going inside.
And that, just to tell me, on what surface you are applying the coating?
Sir, it's a stainless steel surface. the substitute.
My next question is how you prepare the solutions. Just if you can brief me the process.
So these are prepared manually, like we are adding it in a Scott Durand bottle and then putting those solution into the heating these water bath and then put for the shaker, shaking for properly. But even then, like after drying, there is no.
Madam, you are not. Your audible is interrupting. You can come little bit louder, nearer, and to your microphone. And
so Manju, you come your close to your mic actually because the voice is breaking.
Okay. Hello. Is it audible now, sir?
No. Yeah.
Yes. Sir, actually we are preparing it by putting the polymer and the solvent into the Scott Durand bottle, then put that closely tied bottle to the water bath for 2 to 5 hours nearly, okay? Then keep it for the shaking for dissolving the solution. But it seems like it dissolved initially, but when I'm doing drying on that substrate, the solution, the solvent evaporate, but there is no film, like polymer should be there, na? And I come up with only fillers, like there is only fillers are there.
Yeah, can you just tell me what type of fillers? It is silica?
Like these are the additives of polyethylene glycol is there. So it was only there. The result is that there is no polymer. I'm not getting the coating.
No. You see, generally the polymer coats, in terms of paints, the extenders are not visible. Extenders do not give you any visibility. It will be fillers. In our terms, fillers are termed as extenders. The polymer film is there. Of course, polymer film is there, but not visible. But what you can do, you can increase the polymer parts a little bit, and you ensure that during shaking, it is proper mixing is possible. I think it is the same phase ingredients, all are liquid phase, or your solid phase you are incorporating to the liquid phase.
The polymer, the solvent is only solid, rest to it is.
What type of solvent you are using?
Water is the solvent only.
Water will be liquid. It will evaporate.
Solvent is liquid. Rest is polymer is in solid phase.
Proper solution, proper shaking, proper micronization is required. If possible, you can increase the polymer part of the formulations. And you see, polymer film is there, but it will not be visible to you. You can feel it. You can feel it. And if you see that proper mixing is not possible, if you rub the film and see any particles are coming, or if any irregularities you feel in your finger skin, in that case you can see the proper solution has not been prepared. So you have to give a proper thorough mixing times.
Okay.
In case of paste, what we do milling. I will come to the formulations. When you see our polymer formulations in UBQ, I will show you in the formulations right now. Okay. It will be a milling process. So it gives a very micronized. It's measured the particle sizes, dispersed particle size in terms of Hegman. One Hegman, two Hegman, three Hegman. So one Hegman is equivalent to 88.9 microns. So this type of dispersion, that finest grade of dispersion we achieve. And it forms a film. In case of paste, we can see the film. Film is there. In case of clear varnish, we can see a transparent, semi-matte, sheen type of film. It is visible. And one thing it is, if the aluminium substrate you're using, if it is permissible to your purpose, you rub the surface, scratch the surface with a fine grade of emery paper, clean it, and then you apply the film. Because what happens when you scratch the surface, you have several crests and troughs, that's anchoring points developed, and that gives a good addition of the film. You can try this option.
Okay, sir.
So come back to the point. I am now coming you towards the formulations of the UV coat, how it moves. This is a product that has been developed as UV curable liquid top. The shade is the beige shade. Perhaps you are aware of the term beige. Beige is nothing but a creamy, yellowish type of shades composed of white pigments and yellow pigments. This is the stage one. It is how I think I will get answer, Ms. Monju. This is the stage one, is the charging stage. We have the raw materials, list of raw materials, and the weight percentage. As you know, that our formulations is always developed on percentage. It should be 100% formulations. What you're using? You're using a binder. In the case, it is the Laroma ALR 880. This is a polymer, the binder part of the product. It is a liquid top coat, as I have mentioned on the top. It is used as a 45% by weight. What is Laroma? It is a polyester acrylic as a binder, or you can say the short chain link polymer or polyvinyl. We have hexandiol diacrylate, 5.3%. It is acts as a monomer, as a reactive diluent. We have trimethanol propane. These are the monomers that acts as a reactive diluents, 2.64.
Sir, I'm going to
get a jump one.
Hello, may I continue?
You continue. Actually, by mistake, their mic was on. Actually,
okay. Yeah, doctor, you have an answer. Here, in this case, this monomers will act as a crosslinker, and this monomer plays a very important role in the crosslink density. This hexandiol diacrylate or trimethanol propane, triacrylate. We have put titanium dioxide. Is a rutil grade. Is a rutil grade titanium dioxide by 8.82%. This is the opacifying white pigments. We have irigation yellow organic pigments, 3RLTN.98. This gives the color of the yellow pigments. And this grade of pigments is suitable for your UV curable system. In the stage one, the charging has been taken place. Discharges are added in a mill. And then it is dispersed. A certain period of time, you have to run the mill until your dispersion is achieved. And then you stabilize. The second stage comes, the stabilization stage, with the same binders and the monomers. But percentage of binders is kept 15, Laroma, hexandiol diacrylate 3.52, and TPT is 1.76%. Therefore, you see, the whole doses of monomers have been completed in the stabilization stage. Again, it is milled. It has been run for 15 minutes to 20 minutes, and then in drop in enclosed vortex or a mobile tank or a container. And this is balanced at a low stirring with the binders and the initiators. This Irgacure 819 is the initiator of 0.75%. Irgacure 184 is 1.23%. So 100% dosing is completed. The operation is completed. In the next stage, I will show you. Yes.
Yes. Here, if I say, see the stage one and stage two, so stage one and stage two, nearly we are using same material except the TiO2 rutile and ergogen yellow, right? Rest of the components are same.
Because you see, in the liquid yellow Laroma, these monomers, this will be in liquid stage. While we are putting the solid phase materials, titanium dioxide and irgazine, that needs to be dispersed. That has to be, particle size needs to be reduced to make a homogeneous paint film. So milling is important process. Good.
Right.
So it is, you know, it is a dispersion is required. Dispersion is nothing but breaking up of the atom.
My question is that, so why don't we add all these also at stage one itself, and then probably we can go for 20 minute milling or maybe the something like that.
I'm coming to the point, because all binders and all additives you add and mill during milling, you know, there is a kinetic motion. They are all energized. They are all charged particles. If you do not put stabilization stage, and if you avoid stabilization stage, there is every possibility of faster reagglomeration of the particles. The whole purpose of homogeneity will be lost. It needs to be stabilized. You have to energize. While milling, it is new, all the ingredients are highly energized. So it needs to be stabilized, the energy needs to be reduced to give a stable dispersion in a homogeneous medium. The stabilization is required. And this stabilization is possible with the binders and the monomers, which provides a proper steric hindrance. You know, in the paint, the steric hindrance is the most important parameter for the dispersion stabilization. Otherwise, huge settling will take place. The dispersion purpose will be lost. So stabilization is required after a specific time of dispersion. Am I right, Doctor?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So we cannot, you cannot reduce the process time. After this, initiators, you know, these initiators are generally very light sensitive. So in a closed vortex, I mentioned in an enclosed vortex, the balancing at a low speed, the very low shearing force is required to mix these initiators in a larova, in a dispersed mill base. So I'm again elaborating the manufacturing system, how it is, how the product is produced. In a clean.
So I want to interrupt you here for at least for the some other own interests actually. So currently what we are doing, we are actually doing a very the simplified way actually. We are taking, let's say, one polymer, maybe two polymer. We are just taking polymer, dissolving in some solvent in which they can dissolve. And after that, we are doing their drying study, that how much time they are taking for drying. So in that, practically, we are not adding any pigment or something or any color additive, because we are doing some diffusion study or mass transfer model solving. Because if we add some other ingredient into that, so we don't know what way they would react, and to solve those diffusion models, we need some free volume parameters, diffusion coefficient, interaction parameters. So for polymer, well-known polymer solvent, we know all those actually. Or if not, we can calculate from drying experiment, weight loss experiment actually. But if we'll add all these components, let's say TiO2, some other components, some other components, so probably we may end up with the paint, but we will lose at this computation analysis part actually.
Exactly, because they will interfere and they do contribute to the evaporation rate of the solvents also.
Yes, yes, yes. Everything would be yes, yes, yes.
For your purpose, what you can do, what he said.
Our purpose is we finally wants to help to this paint industry, just to have their modeling the computational work. If that is not applicable there, we are just doing one polymer, two solvent, or let's say two polymer, three polymers, or just like that. If it cannot be implemented there, then I hope it's not of much use, right? Just doing a study at some scale, that's fine at primary part. But industrial scale, that may not be much useful, right?
No. I differ from you, Doctor. Don't be so shaky of your work, because we don't know what gems are hidden in your research work. What you can do after making the polymer solutions, besides your studying, you can give it, or you parallelly you can make your system or establish a system and apply your research work in the applied stage. That means you can develop paints, or you can develop any coloring agents, and you can study.
That's what I'm thinking. Now we should add these additives, just like coloring additive, curing additive, or maybe this TiO2, just say for anti-dust property, or let's say hydrophobic property, we can add the silicon and all this. So we are thinking, let's to impart these things, and let's see what can be enhanced in that.
At the end of the day, this will be designed for our surface coating industries. So what is required, you design a model, parallel model of it, apply your research model to that application model, and see, we pour it on a glass panels, pour it on a metal panels, just pour it. Because pouring, it will give you a high film thickness. So you can, some visibility will be there. And if you add color pigments, you can also study that your purpose is being hampered. It is estimated. So far, my knowledge goes, pigments and other additives do contribute to your evaporation rate, diffusible rate. It will interfere.
See, yes, yes, whatever you will add, even if things are there in very low percentage also, they just change complete mass transfer process actually.
But ultimately you can do it, what end user, for what end purpose you are doing, you can model that and correlate it. So that you can have some ideas, you can have some ideas for progress of your research.
Yeah, thank you very much.
What we do here, the ingredients at the charging stage, what I have mentioned, are added in the milling machines. And it is dispersed as per our research, as per our developmental work, it was a dispersion level 3 to 4 Hg. 3 to 4 Hg, when we achieved it, we stopped dispersion, we checked the dispersion, and then the part of the resin and monomer mixtures are added for stabilization. Otherwise, there will be shocking. So stabilization is most important in the paint manufacturing process. We have to give with the polymer and the solvents, which is nothing but the resins and the solvents mixtures with a certain percentage of vehicle solutes are added to it to stabilize it. After stabilization, the dispersed mill base is decanted in a vortex, and balancing of the formulations, that we have to complete the 100% of the balancing, is done by the addition of polymer binders and the photo initiators and mixed slowly by the dissolver. Once the paint is formed, you are doing quality control tests, and that should test is being carried on well primed metal surface. This is done by roller applications with a conveyor speed of about 3 meter to 10 meters per minute, and is cured by 2 high pressure mercury vapor lamps at induced energy of 80 watt per centimeter. This is an arrangement at the lab scale. This experiment was conducted. This is the manufacturing procedure of preparing UV curing coating systems. Is there any question at this stage? Any questions, please?
From my side, no, actually, if anyone wants to ask from participants, participants feel free to ask anytime in between, because the later on, sometimes connectivity, sometimes so many other the reasons come into the picture. So whenever you have a question in the mind, it's better to ask there or type it in the chat box, so that should not be missed out at any case, actually.
And at the same time, it will remove monotonous of this lecture or continue.
Yes. Monotonous. This is just interaction, actually. Interaction in a, you can say formal plus informal, because formal means we are talking to each other. Informal means we are at home. We can eat. We can take tea, snacks, also at the same time. So it is combination of both, actually. We should feel free to interact. Just for interaction with the knowledge sharing, and interaction can help in a long way, actually.
So I am seeing many of the participants are well, they are all expert in their respective field. They can also guide me also for future development.
Yes.
Because we are a professional
something,
manufacturing.
See, one, when we talk to each other, something we give, something we take, actually. And then things grow, actually.
It will be my pleasure if participants also ask questions or give inputs for both of us, mutual benefits. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So now paint has been produced, production has been done, and now we have to go to the lab for the quality control tests. Before that, I want to say something about the paint compositions, what I have used in the formulations. I have told earlier that Ladovite 80 is an unsaturated polyester acrylate, which is as a sole binder, or it can be combined with other radiation curable resins for UV coating systems. It depends upon the formulators to develop the product. Ladovar LR8800 offers excellent hardness and chemical resistance properties. We have used IrgaCure 819 is the universal photo initiator for free radical polymerization of unsaturated resins. This is recommended mainly for white coats and clear coats. Chemically, you can say it is a bisacyclophosphine oxides, IrgaCure 819, it's a SIVA product. I will tell you the suppliers also, so that the persons who are interested to develop product, they can contact with their respective suppliers and they can get the guidance. How to use, what to use, when to use, what to use. IrgaCure, what it...
Because what I feel, this surface coating actually, I feel in that way because many of my seniors from HBTI, they have their own business for that. They some are making pigments, some are making additives, some are making totally a monomer, some are taking some raw materials for this actually. And
yes,
it's if you have some knowledge and with some idea of that, I think we can come up with that business itself.
Yes, exactly. So I am trying to give much as much information that is beneficial to the your research fellows and the students. If they are participating here, they can take their career in that area also. They can start their venture also. They can collaborate with your what I guess alumni of the HBTIs and other technical institutes. Can venture out. So let me continue. IrgaCure 184 is efficient for non-yielding photoinitiator. It initiates photopolymerization of chemically unsaturated pre-polymers with mono or multifunctional vinyl polymers, monomers. It is nothing but it is a 1-hydroxycyclohexyl phenol. Irrigation yellow 3R-LTN is a yellowing pigment. It is a good opacity fine pigment with color index of 56280. This is suitable for your UV coating system. You have to be very careful that not all pigments will be suitable for it, because some pigments have the tendency of absorbing UV. So, and if UV is absorbed, the whole coating process will be thwarted. So you have to be very judicious about the selection of the pigments. Titanium dioxide rutile grade, we have used this type of grade, 902 or 902 plus grade. It's an excellent grade, gives a whiteness, gives a opacity, balances shock resistance, imparts gloss also. It can be used in a wide range of strobing paints, non-strobing paints, both interior and exterior architectural finishes. Trimethyl or propane triacrylate is a multifunctional monomer with a wide range of industrial applications as a cross-linking agent. This also acts as a reactive dimer. These monomers will act as a part of, will behave as a solvents. 1,6 hexane diol diacrylate is used as a functional monomer for polymers, which act as a cross-linking agent also between the molecular chains of polymers. And it improves adhesions, hardness, abrasions, and heat resistance. So each ingredients that have been used in the formulations has specific purposes, what end property we want to achieve. Likewise, you select the ingredients. The diluents, I'm talking of some more diluents and put options of other diluents which you can try. Monoesters of acrylic acids, like octyl, decyl, phenoxyethyl, narbonyl, and dicyclopentadienyl dienyl acrylate, hydroxyl acrylates, acrylic esters of polyols like HDDA, trimethyl and propyl triacrylate, which I have used already in the formulation, pentyl triacrylate, pentyl tetraacrylates are some of the diluents that can be used both for coatings in terms of paints, painting, etc. And what are the role of these diluents, the monomers? Reactivity is measured by cross-link density, which is controlled by the diluents and monomers. This is maintaining viscosity as cross-link density. These diluents also contribute to the properties like hardness, scratch resistance, flexibility, and weatherability. Now, care should be taken in selection of pigments, as many pigments absorb light. Selection of photoinitiators is dependent on type of pigments which reflect UV light. So our focus will be to select photoreflective pigments rather than photoabsorbing pigments. The role of binders, different polymers are available for different purposes. Unsaturated polyesters that improve hardness, improve gloss, and good chemical resistance. Polyester acrylates gives a good chemical resistance. So these polyesters can be used for the protective coatings for the turnkey projects. These UV cure coatings can employ this type of binders. Epoxy acrylates, which gives good chemical resistance and hardness, and is used generally for the undercoats or interior finishes. Epoxy acrylates are not preferred for top coats because of the epoxy group, which split and may initiate to generate free radicals under the influence of UV light. So epoxy acrylates are generally preferred for the undercoats. Polyether acrylates is a very good flexibility and can has a good detergent and soap resistance. So this polyether acrylates has an avenue for the textile coating industries, but the textile coatings can be done with this type of polyether acrylates. Polyurethane acrylates has an excellent weather, non-yielding property and good chemical resistance. Polyurethane acrylates have versatile uses both in liquid paints for normal curing system as well as for UV curing systems. It uses as a top coat and is versatile used for many versatile surfaces. Polyurethane acrylate is most preferred acrylates among the paint formulators. Silicone acrylates is a non-stick coatings, excellent scratch and abrasion resistance. And this silicone acrylates can find avenues in coating utensils and cookware. Non-stick pans, non-stick utensils can utilize silicone acrylates. This is the reactions showing how the binders are produced. This is nothing but a simple chemical reaction where polyester is shown, reacts with acrylic acid, molecule of water is released and forms an epoxy polyester acrylate. This is the reaction of polyester acrylate. I'm showing epoxy resin with acrylic acids forming epoxy acrylates, and polyurethane prepolymers reacts with hydroxyalkyl acrylate, giving polyurethane acrylates. These are the three structures that are shown for just for the refreshing our basic chemistry knowledge. This is the structures of the diluents of the monomers, that is 1,6-hexane diacrylate, 20-ethyl triacrylates, and 2-hydroxyl acrylates. These are the monomers that are generally used in the surface coating industries who are making UV cure coatings. This is the chemical structures of the photoinitiators. This is 2,4,6-trimethanol benzene, phenyl phosphine oxides, the versatile used in the industries, and 1-hydroxycyclohexyl pyrrolyl ketone. These are the photoinitiators, the chemical structures of the photoinitiators. And the role of the photoinitiators is the most important role that photoinitiators plays in the UV curing system. Photopolymerization occurs when an initiator is activated by the radiations, which then transfers the radical to the monomer to start the polymerization process. It's the basic chemistry which you have studied in our class 2 levels. Photochemical initiation is usually achieved by subjecting to suitable photoinitiators or sensitizers to UV light with wavelength of about 200 to 400 nanometer range. Photoinitiators split into two radicals which initiate polymerizations and or cross-linking reactions in subsequent step. Photoinitiators can be divided into two major classes. The first class are the initiators that undergo intramolecular bond scission, and the second class are the molecules that undergo intramolecular hydrogen abstractions. The typical initiators are acetophenol derivatives or a benzophenol and quinone derivatives. This is the photoinitiators. The role of photoinitiator is to initiate photopolymerization reactions, which have been shown in the following arrow equations. Photoinitiators under UV light generates A radical and B radicals. Sensitizer gets energized, but it transfers the energies to the initiator, forming S and complex of charged radicals. These radicals then forms with the bond and forms silicon and hydrogen terminates, and iron radical, initiator radical is generated. This is simple chemistry. That is the basic chemistry of the photoinitiator. The chemical structures of the photosensitizers, that is anthracure UVS 1101, this is Kawasaki Kai Chemicals. They also operate in our country. They supply these photosensitizers. Anthracure UVS 1101 grade sensitizer is very popular sensitizer in the printing industries as well as in the coating industries. It is nothing but 910 diethoxy anthracene. How it rolls, how photosensitizer rolls. This is a diagram, is a UV coating. Not cured UV coatings, where you have initiators marked in blue, we have excited initiators marked in red, and we have anthracure that is marked in class. You see how the enthalpy reacts with the charged radiator, and my purpose of this is to just to give you a visualization how sensitizer real reacts in a system. Sensitizers do not undergo any chemical changes, whereas photoinitiators are consumed during the initiation stage. Sensitizers transfer their energy directly to an energy acceptor molecules, which then produces radicals by other hydrogen abstractions or by photocleavage systems. This is the equation that I am showing, which is the basic state of photosensitizer acts. There are some coatings also which do not use photosensitizers. The photo initiators are sufficient to cure the paint film. That depends upon for what purpose the coating is to be applied, and for what and what type of surface to be coated. Sensitizing effect of anthracure is thick film polymerization is very effective. As told earlier also, I'm repeating a little bit, a short wavelength of UV light, that is the orange line shown in the diagram, does not reach to the deep layer, and it activates only the initiators in the surface layer. So some orange line UV light will only initiate the surface layer. For deep curing, anthracure actively activates the initiators in the deep layer of the UV, which is called a blue line, marked as a blue line in the diagram, and it imparts a thorough curing for thick layers. So that is a homogeneous curing takes place. And there should not be any differential curing on surface coating and deep curing. Otherwise, the paint film will shrink it or shrivel, and the whole purpose of coating will be defeated. The photosensitizer fastens the curing speed under single wavelength irradiation system. That is, photosensitizer is very effective on the UV LED curing system. This is the whole picture presentation of the whole discussion that I have done. This is the photoinitiator and UV irradiation. They react with the reactive species, generate radicals and ions, and the multifunctional monomers. They combine with the radical ions from a cross-linked polymer. That is ultimate paint film. This is the union energy, how the summary of the process, it is initiation process, how the radicals are generated, how the propagation takes place, and how the termination takes place. P stands, I stands for the initiator, M is the monomer, and P is the polymer chain, which I have shown earlier. It is a simple state reactions. The process that has been shown, the three-stage process, initiation, propagation, and termination. But the whole process takes place in a very shortest time. Generally, we have observed this curing process completes within 10 minutes, maximum 10 minutes, 3 minutes to 10 minutes. Even some curing has been developed which can cure in a fraction of seconds. So let me continue with the next slide. The uniqueness of the UV curing system. What I told earlier, that how you can understand the curing system is completed on that. Excellent addition and emicrar property for the UV curing system can be done immediately. Immediately you take it from your curing chamber and you can put it to the acetone and rub test. Paint film does not degrade like waterborne or solvent-based coatings, and it imparts a clean look. Rather, the clarity improves by rubbing of acetone with MEK. Exact applications with perfect matching of film thickness at one shot. What happens in generally the paint system, for mainly for the protective coatings, is a very evaporating type of solvents that they are. We mix the paints. This is a base at the cross-linker, or it is called hardener, two-pack systems are there. We mix at a certain ratio as recommended by the suppliers. We mix it and we keep it. We close the mixing vessel for given time to cure, to film the curing reactions. After a specific time of curing, we then apply the paint. During summer, what happens, the painter finds very difficult to spray the paint, whether that be of air-assisted spray or airless spray system, because of the first evaporation of the solvent and proper flow, proper build is not possible. So they have to add thinners time to time to make it at a consistent application and apply. And what happens, the variation of the film thickness takes place. So there will be a variation of the curing of the paint film, variation in the trial. But this problem or this hassle is totally avoided in this UV curing coating system because we do not use any volatile solvents. It is the monomers that act and behave as a diluents or the vehicle carrier and does not evaporate fast and retain in the paint film. So constant monitoring or viscosity during application is not required here. Chemical composition does not change with time as it is solvent free. Quality control check of the UV cured film can be done immediately after production, thereby making the curing system very fast and productive with high turnaround time. You can immediately transfer the UV cure surface from curing roller to the support roller without deterioration of the cured film. Even in normal auto EM baking system, we give sufficient time of the coated surface to come to the ambient temperature as soon as it comes up, as it exits from the curing chamber. And then it is transferred to the rolling, transferred to the conveyor roller or the supporting roller to take it to the unloading area. But in this coating curing system, curing is baking and unloading takes place in a one place in a very small time. This is the uniqueness of the UV curing system. Since UV does not dry or change its liquid properties over time, the coating application system can be left overnight, over the weekend, even for a week, even for a month, without affecting the coating application system. So this coating system is the unique, and no other coating system as available as of date can match with this unique property. As a result, our risk is minimized. All the above factors are reasons why one should use UV coating system. If the goal is to install the most trouble-free, highest quality coating system to reduce chance of claims, UV coating system is the way to go. The people or the consumer may have some misconceptions of handling UV system because they are afraid of contaminations, self-contaminations. But I can assure that UV curing system is a very highly protective system. And the supplier of this system guarantees the personal protections. And they provide kits, proper goggles, proper apparels, proper masks, proper gloves. They supply it. And the applicator can easily put it on very handable, very usable, very friendly, user-friendly kits. And they can apply the UV curing system. So there should not be any mental taboo in adopting this UV curing system, mainly for the applicators. The success of UV cured paints or printing inks depend on the polymeric binders and monomers, which cover the major part of the formulations. Since there is no solvent in the formulations, both binders and monomers act as reactive diluents and is control the ultimate paint consistency and viscosity. Gentlemen, if you have any questions, you can ask me.
Yeah, I have, but I will ask later, actually.
Okay.
I have so a few questions. Some participants also have it.
Okay.
So we can ask that time.
Great. Then let me continue. That's the painting system. The paints has been developed, paint products have been produced, QC has been checked and has been applied. How it is applied? Generally, this coating system or this painting line consists of spray boot with fixed guns or multi-axis painting machines for 3D structures under controlled environment rules with a high level of quality surface finish. Once I say the controlled environment rules, it takes care of the safety norms of the UV systems. It has a conveyor system for the roller systems as desired by the end user and UV curing machines. This APL Machinery Private Limited is a photo I am putting it here. You can see this is a compact painting system. It is a straight line arrangement, you can say. And it takes a very small area of the system. This is actually a printing line of EPL Machinery Private Limited. It is an Indian company. The company is one of the leading designer and supplier of the machine systems, and they give full solutions of the coatings, and they can guide you about the formulation systems, what type of formulations is required for what type of products. They are that technical experts. Is in general, the headquarters is in Faridabad in Haryana region, and they have different branch units in Bombay and other parts of the country. They are the leader in this painting line system. Some features of this APL systems: it is for flexographic printing line. This is, and this machine, though it is designed for flexographic printing line, can also be used as offline coater for aqueous coatings, for priming coatings. For conventional varnish or water-based varnish can also be done in these machines. The machine is compact and solid and is reliable at any working speed. This machine is equipped with high-grade hardened grounded gears for smooth operations for years. The UV curing lamp that they use are on the best in the world. The major heart of this UVP system is the UV curing lamp. And the most financial part that is occupies is the cost of the UV curing lamps. But this cost is offset by its operational life. It's a very long operational life, and frequent replacement is not required like mercury lamps. It consists of total vacuum bed for continuous combing of paper and board with an efficient 80 cooling system. It can handle from 80 GSM to 450 GSM stocks in one go. It has adjustable double shift detectors, maintenance free varnish replenishment pumps. It can accommodate 2 to 3 UV lamps of 300 watt per inch, which is optional. If you require, you can increase the lamps also. Swing arm gripper for high speed accurate registration of the systems. Micro adjustable front lids for easy and precise registration on the run. Adjustable side lids gives a front instant reverse job registrations. It can deliver accommodate and conveyor for hot air as well as UV dryers. Pneumatically, it is actuated anti-lock roller and impress cylinder can be fitted, is fitted in the system. And you can quickly change this anti-lock roller. Doctor blade assembled with doctor blade angle alignments. It is for the pouring coating system or the roller coating system. This can be assembled. This painting system can be used. Plate clamp suitable for clamping blankets and photopolymer plates. Full PLC control with digital touchscreen human machine interface. That is very user friendly. And it can cure at a speed of up to 10,000 speed per hour. You can assess its output time. A very precise and consistent coating weight with every job. Different models are available depending on the nature of substance to be coated and the compositions of coating to be used. And the users or the applicators can contact with them for customizing the product. What they can adjust the painting line systems accordingly. Now the application areas where the UV coatings are applied. Heat sensitive surface like woods. Earlier we had experience, generally woods are coated with varnishes, polyurethane type, melamine type, malic resins type. Our wood coats are available in the market. It is economical and they apply. But at the same time, when you coat wood, it gives a very smell, pungent and irritating smell of the solvents or the binders. So this can be avoided if we can coat wood with the UV curing coating systems. It can be even applied on ply boards or medium density fiber boards. All kitchen cabinets nowadays are coated with these UV coating systems. Hardwood surfaces or your parquet flooring, you can coat this with UV coating system. Wood moldings, ready to assemble furniture, plastic parts can be coated. In the automotive sector, wheel rims and headlamp lenses, base coats for reflectors, interior parts like dashboards, the rigid and flexible plastic parts, and fiber optic cables find avenues where these UV curing systems are used. And fiber optic cables have nothing but only one choice of UV curing coating system. The metals, it is pipe, tubes, and conduits can be coated. Clear coat and color coats on tubes are possible. Oil coating industries, they also consume this type of coatings. In leather industries, from shoes to leather apparels, are being coated by UV. Printing media, of course, which I told you, all types of offset printing, inkjet printing, offset, flexo printing. In metal painting, deco prints, inks and coatings on can bodies, can ends, can caps, can closures, find areas of applications. How it can be applied? Generally, these coatings can be applied by electrostatic spray gun or corona type or turbocharging spray gun. Roller coater can be applied for prime surfaces of the conveyor belt system with a speed of 3 meter to 10 meter per minute at starting from the entry point of the UV cabinet. The coated surface is cured by pressurized mercury vapor lamps with an induced energy of 80 watt per centimeter or with UV LEDs. Even UV lamp of 100 watt centimeters can be applied. That depends upon what type of products and compositions you are using. Now the supplier parts. Who supplies this type of monomers and the binders? Tom, Dick and Harry do not produce this type of raw materials. Very specialized, very expertized suppliers, and a very few suppliers, they produce this type of monomers. They are the companies like Alnex, Bayer Corporations, Neutro, UCB, Govation. These are the major suppliers. And they also give you the technical know-how of the systems. Why UV curing should be the better choice? Why we are saying it is an open pot life. As in case of protective coatings or in auto EM finishes, pot life plays an important role because it has to give time for the mixing paint materials to cure at a certain level, to react among themselves, and then it is applied. And it delays the process of applications. But in UV curing system, no requirement. It is pot life free product, so you can use as and when it required. It gives consistent printing and consistent colors. It reduces time for cleanup and fewer washes required in case of liquid UV curing coatings. Low make ready waste. For powder coating, you know there is lots of waste during spray applications. But with the designing of monocyclone and multicyclone systems, and proper ventilation fitted with cartridges and vacuum bags, the waste can be collected and can be reused. It dries instantly. The floor space required is very small. Very small area is there required for this UV coating system. It can convert inline from shade switchover to product switchover. You know, the surface coating industries deal with multi-stock, multi-shade inventories, where shade sequencing is an important factor to enhance productivity in the production lines. But in this system, you can easily switch over from sheds and from products. This is an improved properties observed by UV curing system for the inks and the coatings. It gives an improved film load control as 100% solid is achievable. As a wet film thickness, when it converts to dry film thickness, there is no loss at all. So 100% solids is formed in the cured film. It is high, gives imparts high gloss, dot grain in printing process, it reduces. It gives a good solvent resistance, as I mentioned earlier, the MEK rap test or acetone rap test of the paint film. It gives an improved resistance properties. It improves adhesions, environment friendly in terms of very low volatile emissions and safe work environment. The technicals, other technical issues. What I said initially, we have to deal with strength, weakness, threat, and opportunities. These are the major threat areas, which is, you see, the addition to plastics of this coating is found to be a little bit inferior. Some shrinkage is observed, mainly in the shadow areas. For 3D curing system, the shadow care, there's some curing problem is noticed. However, this has been attended, or this has been attended by using double cure system. UV cure, baking plus UV curing system can be utilized for complex 3D structures. Right selection and uses of pigments depending on type of substrate so that it does not block UV light while curing. It need to use right pigment combinations for different shades, need to maintain thickness of pigment coatings, proper dosing of diluents to maintain right application viscosity, proper dosing of lower viscosity oligomers, and selections and uses of proper matting agents. That is, diluents that were used, they impart matting agents. So diluents play an important role in the gloss or optical properties of the paint film. So we have to be very cautious in the selections. Now, what is the commercial threat? Commercial threat is that initial capital cost is high for some go-getter. Retrofitting can sometimes be difficult. Inks and coatings based on UV cooling system may be expensive, but what is apparent is not true. If the cost incurring at the initial level can be compensated by improvements in productivity in terms of superior appearance, functionality benefits, and overall performance. Special training of properties is required initially for the UV inks and coating performance differently compared to conventional ones. So a little bit of skill is required to get a training. Once the trainers, operators are trained, they can easily run the machines. Who are the major players in this market areas? The major players are the ExxonMobil, Arkema Group, Axalta Coating, BASF, Eastman, Evonik, Nippon Paints, PPG, Sherwin-Williams, Valspar. The name of these companies you are well accustomed, I suppose. And majority of the companies do operate in India. Our next part is the focus on the fastest growth powder coating drive. So should I continue, Doctor?
Yeah, you can continue.
Okay. Now I'm coming to product specific. What I have said, low temperature powder coating is growing very fast in our countries also. So let me share some information with all you people. From 2015 till 2019, this market segment has registered global growth around 10%. And for next 5 years, amidst COVID pandemic 19, the expected CAGR will be around 6.5%. So there will be a growth in this industry. The technical reasons of this growth is because of its higher productivity due to fast curing and higher line speed, both energy and time saving. Metal parts can be combined with heat sensitive parts such as during heating and curing phase. The heat sensitive parts such as plastic wares, rubber seals are not damaged because of the low temperature requirements of UV powder coating. So composite accessories and articles can be coated. Spraying can be done with normal corona or turbocharging guns, and for complex 3D structures, electrostatic spray gun can be used. The overspread powders can be recycled to obtain more than 95% of the usage. So you can say, frankly, practically, there is no use losses in this system. Now, how it looks, what is this composed of? The UV coat powder coatings is composed of the resins is required, unsaturated resins, of course, because we need sufficient double bumps to have UV coating curing. You can use up to 60 to 95% by weight. It is a tentative guideline. Photo initiators, that the photo initiators can act on surface. Some photo initiators act in depth, as mentioned earlier. You can use up to 0.5 to 3%. Flow controlling agent, 0.5 to 2%. Degassing agent, 0.5 to 4%. Pigments, 0.1 to 20% as you require. Fillers or extenders, 0 to 35%. And additives, 0.25 to 1%. So this is the basic guidelines of the powder coatings based on which you can design the powder coatings suitable for UV curing system. Let me share with you some research-based formulations. This is the UV curable powder coatings white. Pure white, it should be prepared. The raw materials used is UV coat 2000. Weight is, by weight it is 72. Rutile 25%. Photo initiators 2.5%. And benzoin uses 0.5. The total formulation is 100%. These are the basic raw materials to prepare powder coating. What is the role of UV coat 2000? It is supplied by Alnex. It's an amorphous unsaturated polyester resin for use in UV curable powder coating. The resin has been developed for application on metal substrates and can be used as clear coat as well as pigmented coats. It provides good protection against corrosion on pre-treated surface. For UV cured powder coatings, epoxy acrylates or polyester acrylates, as I have shown earlier, can be chosen because of their high glass transition temperature or high suffering temperature. Heat sensitive surfaces like medium density fiberboard is the most suitable substrate for such coatings and curing techniques. The resulting powder coatings offer excellent resistance to chemicals and mechanical impact. So selection of raw materials has definite purposes. Benzene is act as a degassing agent for powder coatings. You know that powder coatings are when trapped years. During curing, the powder coating film, this benzene melts and chemically scavenges oxygen and promotes dissolution of gases into the resin matrix to minimize bubble formation in the coating film. If there is a bubble formation, so the paint cure film will come out with the blisters. The bubbles will burst and give you several craters and crests and troughs on the surface. And the whole purpose of the beauty of the film, the protective function of the film gets affected. So some special additives are added here. Alternatively, we can choose 1,4 cyclohexane dimethanol dibenzoate. Chemically, it is CHDM dibenzoate, which gives excellent coatings with less yielding at levels 3 to 9 times higher than that of benzoate in epoxy hybrid powder coating system. So you have an options, and you can use it at whatever level you want with respect to benzoate. So while designing powder coatings, we have to take care that it should not yellow after curing. And it should not, paint films should have uniformity, uniform level, uniform finish, no blister marks, no bubbles on it, or no scratches or no shrinkage. This is the pictorial representations of the UV curing system. Under normal thermal thermosetting powder coatings, the powder coating melts, flow, and then cure. The total time takes is 10 to 30 minutes in this system. What is an UV coating system? You see, it is melt and flow in 1 minute, and within second it is cured. And the temperature is almost 93 degrees centigrade is generated, which can withstand the surface itself. So you can see within 5 minutes, our process from surface pre-treatment to finish can be achieved in this curing system. Cross-linking technology is used in UV curable powder coatings after melting and flow out of the powder under the influence of heat, which may be by IR UV, heating system, convection system, or combination of both. The molten film is cross-linked by exposing it to UV light for a fraction of seconds instead of minute, as in the case of thermosetting powders. The absence of thermal cure during the melting of UV powder allows optimum flow out, makes smooth finishes achievable at relatively low temperature. This is the main mechanism of the curing system, which has been shown in the preceding picture. This is the comparative studies of the curing of powder coating, heat setting powder coatings. Under convection system, you see 140 to 220 degrees centigrade is required. And the curing time is 15 minutes to 30 minutes, and is suitable for metals. For IR convection system, from 140 to 220 degrees centigrade, curing temperature, time is 25 minutes to 10 minutes, that is suitable for metals. IR system, 15 minutes maximum time, suitable for metal substrate. Induction heating system, where you can raise the temperature from 240 to 300 degrees centigrade. Maybe your curing time is less, but on metal substrates. But in the UV powder system, what we are discussing now, is suitable for both IR convection UV curing, and it takes 1 to 2 minutes. Temperature is maximum 140 degrees centigrade. Curing time is 1 minute to 3 minutes. And this system is suitable for metal, wood, plastics, or composite of either. So you can see the benefit of this curing system. The system area. It is seen that typical UV powder coating system requires almost 2,050 square feet. It is estimated on reality ground. Whereas thermal powder coating plant size is about 15,000 square feet area. Within 2,050 square feet, you can accommodate your preparation tank, pre-treatment tank, your powder coating application areas, melt oven areas, coating areas, unloading areas, and loading areas. So the photo what I showed you initially of the AP manufacturing system justifies this, that a small area you can install this system, and means it gives you a substantial financial savings for installing this system. types of spray guns which I mentioned earlier is a corona charging spray gun and turbo charging spray gun. They have two different functions. Let me share with you. Corona charging spray guns, where negatively charged powder particles under the influence of ionic field are transferred to the grounded object to be coated. In the turbocharging spray gun, the powder coatings are positively charged and is generated inside the tube of the gun and transported to the grounded object to be coated. These are the two differences of the painting spraying system. These are pictorial representations of the corona spray gun, where you see the electrode and the switch, and the ionic field is generated, and the negatively charged particles gushes to the obstruct object, which is earth, and it forms a uniform layer on the coated surface, where the fluidized powder acts as a cascading action within the gun of the corona. In the turbo spray gun system, the positive particle cells are generated inside the tube, as told you. And under the airflow pattern, these charged as well as the uncharged particles move along the airflow patterns towards the substrate, which is neutralized by grounding or by an earth, and it coats the surface. So in the corona charging, the negative powder charged particles coat the surface, but in turbo charging, positive charged particles coat the surface. The testing standard parameters followed in these industries are highlighted below. It is ASTM method, American System of Test Methods, NEMA, National Electrical Manufacturing Association, American Test Method, PCI Test Method, which is Paint and Coating Industries, GSB International, which is German standard, QualiCode, which is Class 1 and Class 2, which is generally followed in the European market, and AMA 260498, that is American Architectural Manufacturers Associations, who set the testing parameters for the doors, panels, window panels, handles, toiletries items. They generally specify the standards of this system. What are the quality checks generally carried out for these UV coating systems? Color analysis. After all, we coat the surface for color applications are there. We decorate the paint with color shades. So color analysis is required. With different type of spectrophotometers is given below. X-ray is very popular in the paint industry. Color assessment, we after coating, we can visually color assess, but under normal light, we also check the colors, or on the fluorescent light, TL84, fluorescent, incandescent, and ultraviolet light, or NIST traceable documentation system, where we can visualize the color. What type of lamps we generally use? In the micro UV lamp, the 300 watts, 600 watts for micro UV lamp with V-bulb system. Coating thickness as per ASTM methods, abrasion resistance system, though as ASTM D4C0 system, adhesions, surface areas, these are as per ASTM test. Pencil hardness, scratch hardness, as it is very popular in the industry, same test methods are followed for the quality checks. Impact resistance as per NEMA standards, mandrel bed stress as per ASTM standard, gloss levels, the glossometer with ASTM method, and for MDF surfaces, that is water resistance, so this is the NEMA-like specification systems are followed. Cleanability and stainability test, it is for the furniture industries. Curing analysis as per PCI test methods for make it up test. Texture evaluation systems are followed. For MDF surfaces, we generally follow ASTM methods, all ASTM methods and NEMA methods. This is the test descriptions I've given, which I can share you if required. I can send by email also if you are interested. And these are the test parameters, what thickness should be there. 3 to 4 mils is the film thickness. 1 mil, please keep it in mind, is 25 micron. 1 mil is equivalent to 25 micron. And 1 micron is, 1 hegmin is 88.9 micron. The abrasion resistance test by keeping wet, pencil hardness test with 2H pencil and 3H pencils. Gloss meter generally tested at 60 degree, but you can check gloss at 20 degree and 80 degree angles. Then impact resistance, cleanability resistance, as mentioned earlier, are the sum of the QC parameters that need to be checked as per the NEMA method or ASTM method. Other results are given. You can test and you can check the results. That in case of cleanability stain, there should not be any permanent effect on the samples. In MEK swap, that should not be the softening of the color film. In boiled water test, it is no blistering should appear in the pure film. In addition test, addition must not fail. Must not fail in this system. This is the, now I'm coming to the commercial part, little bit. Technical part is over. You can compare the thermosetting powders, UV powders, and the liquid coatings. You see there are the six color bands. The blue band gives a time span for coating applications. Untinted square indicates melt and flow time. UV cure is the light blue. Solvent flush is the pink. Thermal curing marked as the deep purple color. And the cooling is more dark indigo purple colors. You see in UV power coating, the cure is takes place within fraction of seconds, 0 to 1 minute. You see the white band under UV power is a very narrow band. It is about 1 to 2 seconds and it cures. So within 0 to 10 minutes, your UV powder can cure. Whereas in thermoset powder curing system, you have to give time of application time, same as that of UV powder coating system. Then you see the curing system, thermal curing. It takes about 30 minutes there for curing. Then it comes the part of cooling system. So thermosetting powder takes 0 to 50 minutes. Generally, it is takes the time for 100% curing. But in liquid coating, you have to give additional time of pink band, that is that the solvent flash system, in case of auto EL finishes. When you paint paints, industrial strobing finishes, you have to give time for the solvent to flush up. Otherwise, solvent popping will occur during curing. So it takes 0 to 40 minutes plus liquid coat system. So UV powder coating is the fastest curing system with respect to any other coating systems as is available as on date. The impact of carbon footprint. The carbon dioxide emissions per meter square, it is for two-pack solvent bond system, it is 0.96 per mil of coating. Water bond system gives 0.35. Whereas UV powder is only 0.21 kilogram per mil of coating. The thickness achieved, solvent bond is 5 mils. For water bond, it is 2 mils. In powder coating, it is also 2 mils in thickness. But coating carbon footprint, you see it is 4.8 kilogram per meter square in case of solvent bond system. Whereas for powder coating, it is simply 0.41 system. So it is minimum impact on the environment. The material cost per square of foot of the surface coating, you see the UV powder spray system, it is taking 0.02 cost, but the powder spray is 0.3 copeck, for liquid 2 coat low volatility is 0.3 copeck. The parts produced per day, where if you 388 equipments are achievable coating, for the liquid system, in powder coating system, whether that will be a spray to waste or spray to reclaim, you can achieve 1,164 components you can cure per day, and which is collaborated in the graphical sheet. Keeping in mind, it is 8 hours one shift operation system. If it is a two shift operation, automatically output will enhance, keeping your material cost per square foot same. The revenue and the marginal gross earning, it is highest in case of UVPO spray to reclaim system. It is 8.142 gross margin compared to 6.8 in spray to waste system under UVPO, but in liquid coat it is 2.4. Naturally, the gross margin is very high. Gross margin is the difference between the total revenue per day and with the total margin. Total revenue minus total margin gives you the gross margin. But similarly, your operating margin is also reflected, where 19.99% operating margin before earning before income tax deduction. EBIT stands for earning before income tax deductions in the balance sheet. So your UVPO spray to reclaim gives the highest operating margin with in comparison to UVPO spray to waste. margin, which is 8.56%. Still, it is higher than the liquid two-port system. So, UBTO spray to reclaim operating margin will be highest of 19.99. And these parameters, this financial data, suppose that one should opt for UV curing system, especially for the go-getters who want to contribute to the environment as well as to contribute to the consumer. The cost-benefit analysis, it is a very fast, clean, and green. Solvent-based coatings have highest environmental footprint. Waterborne coatings have low environmental impact, while UV curable coatings have lowest environmental impact. Application and material cost per square feet is least. Number of parts produced is almost 200% more than this baking system. Revenue and operating margins are much higher than the conventional curing system. It is a one-step attractive finishes, and the formulation can be designed accordingly. It is a special type of finish for texture to hammer finish, can also be the cure under this curing system, and this poses no problem. The three tips that I want to share with you for successful UV coating process is, you can switch over to narrow spectrum LED lamp from broad-based spectrum lamp because of its consistent output, no requirements of replacing lamp, longer operational life with consistent output, and no warm-up time. Optimization of doses by setting empirically minimum doses and add up to 25% keeping safe factor. That means when you install a system, you apply the paint and cure the system, giving different curing time. You optimize it, and then you enhance it by 25% and make it as a permanent setting time for the UV curing system. So this is possible for you to achieve higher productivity and higher performance when the system will be in full operations. In a easy safety management, while lamp supplier will provide you the IOS and PPE and proper initial training. Now let me review the total presentations. It is the concluding part of my presentations. So with innovative chemistries and coatings meeting market specific demands, this industry can offer better than average gross processing margin and grow at an above global gross domestic product. Coatings cured with UV light offer increased benefits over thermosetting coatings in terms of faster curing cycles with lower temperature requirements and higher energy savings. This method of curing, that's low temperature UV cure powder coating, proves to be highly beneficial for heat sensitive substrates, as mentioned earlier also, wood, plastics, and alloys. UV curable powder coatings can facilitate higher line speed, higher productivity, as well as substantial savings in terms of time, energy, and space. So, UV curing system will be the future safe for surface coating industries, and will be one of the important market drivers for future growth of this industry. And this was my whole purpose, to share my experiences with you people. Over to you.
Yes, sir. Actually, thank you very much. Such a elaborative, informative, and covering I would say that entire paint industry, actually, what various means application are there, and emphasis on UV curing process. And practically, I will say that I am doing some coating work from this last, you can say from 2003 to till today, actually, so including the time of my PhD, and you can say 17 years, actually. But I was doing completely a theoretical side of that modeling computational work. And from today, the lecture, actually, your thing, I learned a lot, actually, and previous lectures were there by Professor Juan, actually. Dr. Juan, actually, I learned a lot with how the basic fluid mechanics principle can be applied for coating applications just for dye. I have a number of questions, so let the participant ask first. If they have the questions first, they can ask. So, participant side, anyone wants to ask the questions, Mr. Pervi, that's first.
Yeah,
and then I will ask my questions. So from participant side, I have one question from the Manju Rawat. She said that what is the basic test to check whether the coating is scratch resistant, defect free or not without going for characterization? Is it possible without characterization to know somehow?
No, it will not be possible.
Practically, it's not possible.
Then you have to do instrumental analysis, that is spectrophotographic analysis. You are more expert in that field. Other than this manual testings, that what I mentioned, the point test, rough test, scratch, pencil hardness. This is a standard procedure on the coating industries, because this will give you the right reflections, doctor, that whether that curing has been achieved or not. Theoretically, or by instrumental analysis, you may achieve to a certain point. You can land up with a certain figures, land up with a certain equations, land up with a certain equations. But in practically, unless you do these physical testings, you cannot give proper value to your assessment. So I think this type of test methods, which is universally accepted, STM, NEMA, they are the main forerunners in this field.
Yeah. Second question from my another student, Debyani, do you want to ask that or do you want me to read that? I think she's having some mic problems. So I can read the question actually. Her question is that as several components use provides hardness, then after a period of time due to excess drying or some effect, will it lead to cracks on coating, on folding or moving the surface?
In that case, I will say the design of the formulation is defective. Components does not impart detrimental effect if it is rightly chosen, right doses of ingredients. If excessive drying happens, when you put excessive dryers, or when there are two types of dryers, you know, doctor, that is thorough drying, surface drying, cold drying. So if the dryer doses are not properly optimized, the one of the dryers will play a foul role, and it will automatically hamper the curing of the paint film. Though it will appear initially cured, it will affect the surface. So right doses and right selections, which means several trials and errors of the formulations. And since you are using different components, so trialing as you do it naturally, I don't have to share with this, but still I am like to tell you, suppose you are putting n number of components. So in that n number of components, you select one component varied, keeping other components constant. So gradually you can optimize your doses of different components and your product design will be perfect.
Okay, sir. Thank you. One more question from Mr. Sushant Kumar Sethi. Any process to make free polymeric film not coated on any substrates using UV curing technique? What does it mean, free polymeric film? Actually, I am also not getting. What do you want to say that free polymeric film?
Because without polymer, the film will not form.
Yeah, because otherwise it will be the metallic coat actually, so that will become metal only. Mr. Sushant, can you elaborate your question actually, if you can hear me? He say you can say polymer film actually. So he want to say that any process to make polymer film not coated on any substrate using substrates is required, right? Without that film,
see the film. The film cannot lay on the substrate.
You can do a gravity film, but as far as my side is the answer is concerned, you can drop the solution at a thin sheet. But in that case, you cannot control its thickness, its surface. You cannot control anything. You will get the something actually.
But irregular,
Yeah, totally irregular actually. So because your surface, your buoyancy, your flow rate will disturb the entire texture of the surfaces.
And if it is highly surface active, highly surface tension, it will appear as a bubble on the surface.
Yes, yes, yes. Any other question from anyone?
Please.
In the meantime, I may ask my question if you allow, actually. So, can be means have some lab scale UV curing. So, in that case, can we use this UV lamp actually for the laboratory purpose and can do?
Exactly. Yeah, Haryana is at your near distance. I have given the API through internet.
Yes, yes, yes.
Get the number, or I can also share with you. You talk with them. APL, there are other companies also, not only APL, but APL is rated to us as a number one in this scoring system.
Okay.
And they customize it. If you
Okay. Depending on need, also they customize it. Okay. Thank you very much. One more thing. Are there some work is going on this biodegradable polymer film?
It is the I think Berger Paints Research and Development and Asian Paints, they are doing some work.
So because I am thinking to go in this direction, biodegradable and water-based coatings actually.
Doctor, can you just elaborate me a little bit about biodegradable polymers? I am interested to know.
Biodegradable means, let's say you have, for time being, you want to protect something for a temporary purpose. Temporary for time being, let's say for a period of 1 year or 10 years. Or let's say sometime, I will say, we want to implant a bone actually. So previously people used to put a rod, metal rod.
Mm-hmm.
So it is permanently being fixed inside the body. Now people, because the body automatically heals itself, develop the bone density and over the period of time.
Mm-hmm.
So that that external, the material which you have the put inside the body, that need to be the replaced out over the period of time because we don't want it.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise it create the some problems inside the body. So people are coming, let's say, some the material, less like PMMA or some other materials, these are the very, give very tough strength as compared to bones. And those are being fitted inside. But we want to make at the same time biodegradable so that, let's say, we are the hoping, let's say, in 5 years' time, body will itself heal up and the recover the bone. So after 10 years, we want that polymer to degrade itself so that we need not to do another surgery to take out that external the material which we are imparted.
Great.
So it's degrade over the period of time, actually.
See, yeah.
Just like polythene bags. So polythene bags, if you will just throw out in the environment, it won't the degrade 1,000 years.
Yes, Amway was the first company to introduce this biodegradable packaging materials. Amway. You know the name of Amway.
Yeah.
They have that user-friendly. Do you put in the soil? Rather, it acts as a fertilizer. This packet deterioration acts as a, this value adds to the soil as a fertilizer, converts to fertilizer. So, yes, it is what I have read in a journal, European coating journals. Some in Belgium and some in America, some laboratory are working on these ideas.
Okay.
I don't know whether India, IHEs or other renowned institutes, they're working on it. But in the medical field, it will be totally in the medical
field. Yeah, medical field. People are giving medical, just like your capsules and all this. Capsule is also a biodegradable polymer only. So you are encapsulating the drug. And focusing at a particular place for control drug, the release kinetics also.
Yeah.
Is slowly the release permeates the thing. So just a membrane actually.
For the carcinogenic treatment also.
Yeah. Second thing I just want to ask that you have shown some cost revenue, the data of this paint industry, something, right?
Yeah.
If we want to do some study further, what are the various sources just to go get these data actually?
Yeah, This is the data. Can you see the graph?
Yeah, we can see. So what are the various sources from where we can collect such type of the data for our analysis later on?
In that case, it is a price with the parameters you set up, simple graph, simple. You do the costing of your formulations to get the prices.
No, we will do a power, but we, let's say we want to see a power market competitor, or let's say industry worldwide, or maybe in India, or maybe at the somewhere. Can it possible to get some such type of data?
Then you have to search internet. Yes, they do. They produce, because our paint, it is a data for the paint industry. They furnish data. You can get it. I can share it to my data. It is not a problem. But up to date data, you have to tap.
There are the some agency, something just like in the US, there are something market price reporter websites. So they provide some chemical engineering data actually.
They put techno commercial data. You can get
Okay.
You can get it. Let me find it out. I am looking it. If I get any internet address, I will share with you.
So one more questions from my side, that the in the UV querying actually, these are all of them are the solvent free, right?
No, first part I discussed solvent. This is all solvent free. Yes, these are all solvent.
All when the solvent free, so the. There is no question of the solvent entrapment on high drying and all this.
It is a monomers that acts as a
Yes.
The uniqueness of this system is that no solvent.
But monomer, once it will cross-link, it may also give some a water molecule also, right? Or that may get encapsulated the somewhere.
If it gets, generally, that's why I am telling you right doses. Because the monomers, if that be, that will be in the ionic form. Doctor.
Okay.
So it is, there is tendency. Yes, there is some free radicals residue may be there, but the design is such it is encapsulated within the polymeric structures.
Then there will be no question of the solvent actually.
Possibility is there, but it should not. But in the case, I am just sharing you some work is done in in France or here. They are working with new polymers which will arrest this your purpose.
Okay.
I will share. Yeah.
Thank you very much for that. Yeah. One more question, the last one from my side there. You said the application in UV ink. So ink is generally used, this you call for the UV ink for large scale commercial printers or let's say some other purpose ink?
No, it is UV cure coating special ink, not the normal conventional coating inks. It will be a special ink. As same as, there will be no solvents. And same consistency like paste, you can apply by roller, you can apply, it is generally by triple roll or double roll, you can apply it.
You can say that the printing of the metal objects or maybe some hard object on an industrial scale.
Exactly. Industrial scale. That's what I'm saying. In flexography, it is metal. Lithography, it is different, flexible packing.
So I will say it was indeed a wonderful lecture, and I learned from here, because from over the years I was searching what instrument should I use just to check the color, hardness, average resistance, scarce resistance, and BR and TR, that the refractive index of my coatings. So 2 years back I found one US company, Paul and Gardner, that is a good company, I think. So I found there they manufacture all of these, actually all coating instruments actually.
Beak is there. Beak, BYT. Beak.
Okay. And from your presentation I learned there are some Indian companies also there which can help me in that way. They
are working on
I will contact them, and we will develop the lab for at least our lab as soon as possible. Currently I have a DST funded project actually, so in that I don't have grant for purchasing, but later on, let's say, we can buy from the instrument institute for
you belong to a renowned institute, NIT.
I would say, sir, this was really excellent, a wonderful lecture. Actually, you have shared a lot of information, and I myself learned a lot because being
sharing,
I just found in the meantime that I was doing working from 17 years in this field, and I don't know even 7% of the coating industry.
Don't be so humble, doctor. Because you are all...
I really, sir, I will say frankly, I really learning a lot from these sessions, and so I'm sure these participants also, are getting good ideas, innovations, just to do some sort of R&D work at their end. One last question there, because as far as the paint industry in India is concerned, we know, because maximum time we end up with few names, just like Berger, Asian Paint, Royal, Narolec, and Exonables, and Max Specialty, and all this. Right. So if it is possible that if you can share some list of the companies so that we can have some good... database just for student job point of view and for our own interest also, just to collaborate the people, just to work with them, because sometimes it's not possible to buy each and every characterization technique, so we may collaborate them for testing part also.
Okay, I will share by today evening. I will give you the list of
you can take your time, sir. There are no hard and fast.
I will, and it's my pleasure also for giving me opportunity. Thanks to your faculty members that you have chosen me as one of the participants. Day one, I was there as a speaker.
Day one, you were there. We were planning months actually, and so many complications came, which we don't want to discuss it here. But I'm really thankful to you and other experts who really supported a lot actually, and finally this program has succeeded actually. I will say succeeded.
Hope to meet you in fear of future also.
Yes, definitely.
And most thing is that what I am concluding, just thank you to everybody and stay safe. That is the most
important. Yes, sir. So thank you very much, sir, once again. So we will close this session here actually.
Then I am signing.
And thank you very much, sir.
We will start the next.
So the next session will start at 2:50 actually.
I will join.
By Dr. Karnal Singh on film formation in water-based in the dispersions. So we will participant can take the break and they can get connected after the 20 minutes. The something actually we can start 3:55. 2:55. Sorry. No, 1:55, sorry, we got 2 o'clock.
Take it, push up.
Okay, sir, thank you very much.
Stay safe, everybody.
Yes.